Okay, we are continuing. In the previous hour, at the end of previous hour, I shown you four different cases. The first one was looking like a good fit with R square close to one. The second one is a poor fit. R square is almost zero. The third one, well, looks fine for most of the variables, most of the observations, but R square is not close to one because there is an outlier, okay? The outlier, well, I mean, the outlier adversely influences the result, negatively influences the result, okay? For the fourth one, again, the R square value is much less than one. The data is squeezed to a very narrow region, but at a very further point, there is one outlier, and that outlier is causing this kind of a blue model, which finally ends up with a very poor R square value. Okay, so basically, I should start with defining these statistics. I mean, this is in a matter of statistics, okay? And artificial neural networks is also a very tightly blended with the notions of statistics. And there are a few very simple quantities. The sum square of the total is yi, okay, yi, the y values, y-axis values, minus the average of the y-axis value. You square the difference and sum when I runs from 1 to n. For all those samples, all those red circles, you take the average of the y value, and for each one of those samples, you compute the deviations in the y-axis from the mean and add them up. That is SS total, sum square of the total. Sum square of the regression does the same thing for the blue model's responses, okay? yi hat minus y bar squares produce the sum square of the regression. And SS, yeah, sum square of the residuals is the yi minus yi hat. I mean, yi minus yi hat is the error of the model, okay? I mean, the difference in between any red one and the corresponding point in the on the blue line, okay? That is the error, yi minus yi hat squared, and it is added up when I runs from 1 to n, okay? R square value is defined as 1 minus sum square of the residuals over sum square of the total, or which is equal to sum square of the regression over sum square of the total. Okay. So this is basically sum square of the residuals. If this is, I mean, there is a perfect match when yi hat is equal to yi, you see that this error is zero. If there is a perfect match for all samples, then this is equal to zero. So the best value of R square is equal to one, okay? One minus zero over something, this means that one. So the best model produces a one as the R square value. It is saying that when R square is close to one, your model is good, okay? Okay, now come back to the model, and we will make some manipulations. For the This one, we will keep this as it is because it is nice. For this one, we will change the structure of the model as said here, okay? We will change the structure of the model. When you change the structure of the model to 2, you see that since there is no noise, R squared is equal to 1, okay? R squared is equal to 1. So your model is perfect, okay? For the cases in the bottom row, I eliminated the outlier standing here and I eliminated the outlier standing here, and I obtained two models which are really perfect, okay? R squared is 1. Basically, this is telling me that pre-processing of the data, trying to spot the outliers, is an important business, okay, for learning statistical or other learning theories. For all learning theories, spotting the outliers is a big business, okay? As you see, now my model is good. My model is good here, okay? So there are core clef comments in MATLAB. It is possible to use, well, this is from Wikipedia. This text is from Wikipedia. I will not read it, but it is really a very simple code that lets you obtain those quantities, okay, and obtain the value of R square, okay, or using CoreCoef. It is possible to use the correlation coefficient and obtain the R square value, okay. So there are equivalence in between the commands in MATLAB. I will not go into that. Well, yes, I will go into that. I will go into that. There are 100 data. One, this is my noise level. This is my horizontal axis, observation horizontal axis. This is the added noise. This is my process. This is the order. And this is my A matrix, okay, for the least mean squares algorithm, okay, for the A matrix. The first way is to do the algorithm as I have already told you. This is the first method. Using the MATLAB comments, it is possible to obtain the polyfit and polyval comments. Well, those give you the same result, okay, y hat 1 is equal to y hat 2, x1 is equal to x2. The third method is to use the regress command. Regress command produces a regression in between these predictors and the observation outputs that is producing x3, and those three x values are the same x values, okay? And this is an interesting application of LMS algorithm. The parameters are changing. Your model parameters are changing. Let me explain. There is a dynamic process. Pk plus 1 is dependent on the previous value of Pk, okay? And some external signal is entering into the difference equation. Pk plus 1 is equal to 3 Pk plus 4 Uk, for example, okay? Those x1 and x2 are the, let's say, parameters of this model. This is a dynamic system. This system has parameters. Those parameters are x1 and x2, and those parameters are changing. Let me say that you are able to observe the value of P's and U's. I mean, U's are the external inputs, P's are the observed quantities, okay? All right, X1 is time varying, X2 is time varying. This means that X1 is X1K, there is a variation in time, it is changing in time. X2 is X2K, it is changing in time. For this kind of a problem setting, which is, I mean, those from electrical engineering will recognize, these are, you know, in filter theory, adaptive filter theory, in dynamic system theory, in control theory, digital control theory, these kinds of models are available. So in adaptive control, in nonlinear adaptive control or linear adaptive control, these kinds of models are available. So there are changing parameters, and now you are making some observations. If you do the same usual least squares algorithm, what will be your result? If it is poor, how can we improve it? Okay. Any suggestions? Any suggestions from your side? Any suggestions? Mert Ozan? Any opinion?
I don't have, actually.
Tarık?
I don't have an idea, sir.
Fırat?
I don't have any idea.
Doğan? Doğan'da tık yok. Betül?
No, sir.
Well, if the value of those parameters are changing, and as time progresses, as time passes, the old values, the past values are basically useless, right? Past values are useless, right? The recent values, the recent observations are valuable, but the past values are useless. So I have to forget the past, focus on the recent observations. Does it work? Because the values are changing, so I should make my predictions using the recent values, which are very close to the correct or instantly correct values. And I have to forget the old values of those parameters. So I will produce a matrix representation. Okay, P1 is equal to X10, P0, X20, U0. Okay? That is P0, U0 times X1 hat, X2 hat. I will be trying to produce an estimate of X1 and X2 depending on my observations, okay? There it is. This is B, this is A. There are two columns. This is the output, okay? This is the output of my representation. So I will introduce a weight matrix, which gives more importance to the recent observations and less importance to the past observations, okay? For farther past in the past observations, okay? This omega is a weight matrix, and I will establish my problem with this representation. Omega times W times A times X hat is equal to W times B, okay? Now I will show you the inside of the W matrix. Now I will multiply both sides from the left by omega A transpose, okay? As I should say here. Omega A transpose omega A times X hat is equal to omega A transpose times omega B, okay? Well, sometimes I'm saying omega, sometimes W, well, both the same thing, okay? And the solution, take the inverse of this thing, multiply both sides by this inverse from the left, as shown here, okay? That will give you omega A transpose omega A inverse times omega A transpose omega B. That is A transpose omega A inverse times A transpose omega B. That omega transpose omega is defined as Q. This is basically telling me that my X hat is A transpose Q A inverse A transpose Q B. Algebraically, this looks nice. Let me show you an implementation of it. This is how my omega matrix looks. The most recent value, is n. Time is very close to my current time, okay? Time is very close to now. This is the very bottom element, and that very bottom element is very valuable. And the one previous one, delayed one, is multiplied by, weighted by lambda. And the second further measurement is weighted by lambda square. And it goes like this, okay? Since lambda is in between 0 and 1, the most recent one is most valuable. And the very, very early one is the least valuable, okay? And this lambda is called the forgetting factor, okay? Forgetting factor. Are you okay? Okay. I will do this within a prediction window that is 300 observations, okay? There is going to be a prediction window. And after collecting a number of data, I will implement my algorithm. This is my process. This is the second line is showing me how X1 is changing. It is now going very sharply to 0.9, staying there for a while and going to minus 0.9, staying there for a while and going up again. Okay, it is a sharp signal. X2K is a minus cosine something. It is a continuous thing going like this, okay? It is going continuous thing going like that. N is equal to 300 observations. I mean, after 300 observations, I will open my algorithm, okay? And lambda is equal to 0.95. Why? Well, by trial and error, okay? Please pay attention to the figures. There are two subplots. The upper subplot is X1. Lower subplot is for X2. The upper subplot shows you with the dashed red line, the true values, correct values. Okay. And in the bottom, you see the correct value of X2 in the bottom subplot. Okay. Now, my classical algorithm produces these blue curves, these blue predictions, okay? Your parameters change, but it very gradually goes there and converges, okay? Your parameter changes. As long as it stays there for a long time with no change, it catches that parameter, okay? The blue one. The blue one is trying to follow the red dashed signal as shown in the bottom figure with some delay, okay? Because you are collecting the data, producing the least mean squares algorithm prediction and reproducing the result. Then obviously there is a delay, okay? When it comes to the forgetting factor algorithm, least mean squares with the forgetting factor algorithm, I obtain the green curves, green results. Basically, what I see very quickly is that green signal in average performs much better than the blue one. Okay, it very quickly finds the correct values and it is able to follow the parameter changes accurately. Okay. Do you see that? Green one is accurately following the parameter changes, but the green one is more vulnerable, more vulnerable to the instant changes in those parameters. Since there is this change from 0.9 to minus 0.9 here in the red one, you see there's a fluctuation here, okay? There is a, because the most recent observations are more effective in the results, okay? Since the most recent observation contains a very sharp change, it is basically observed as a fluctuation in the result, but it eventually converges, okay? Again, we see the effects of those fluctuations here, okay? We see the effect of those fluctuations here. Effect of what? What is that? There are zero crossings. Zero crossings are influencing the algorithm. Basically, your parameters are changing. Least squares algorithm works fine. And you should be, you know, choosing one or the other. The blue one, if there are no changes in your parameters, it finally finds the correct value. Okay, that is good. If the change is really very slow, yes, blue one could be okay. But if there are cases like the one you see on your screens, the blue one is useless. The green one, at the cost of those instant fluctuations, the green one is better. If you decrease the value of the forgetting factor, you will see other results. If you increase the value of forgetting factor, if you get close to one, you will see other results. I would very highly recommend for you to code, but produce your own code to see the effects of those parameters and results. Basically, least squares algorithm is a very powerful algorithm. Okay, please keep that in mind. In every learning theory centered course, you will see that least squares algorithm, together with some variants like the one we see here, I mean, it could be linear or nonlinear. Linear in the parameters, it has to be linear in the parameters, but the predictors could be nonlinear, okay? And you obtain your own result. Fine. There is this very historic paper, Widrow and Hopf. And Bernard Widrow is a very, well, famous person because he is the discoverer of the Adaline algorithm. Adaline means that you are combining parameters to get a result, as we are doing in the least mean squares algorithm, okay? There is a very nice lecture here. Let's say half an hour lecture. I will not run it. This is the Bernard Widrow, the person. Okay, this is the person, and he explains that this is a professor of Stanford. He explains how they discovered at a particular point of his talk. He says we discovered the LMS algorithm. No, this is revolutionary. And they developed a machine. And he really implements a manual training of a machine to learn a particular training data, okay? You can see this is the first part, and that one is the second part of the algorithm. Yes, this one is the second part. I will share that with you. Here it is. Okay, His name is Bernard Widerow, and this is the title. You can go to YouTube and try to understand what is happening here, because this is one part of the coming week. Probably this is going to be a part of the coming week, next week. And I hope you watch it and come back to, try to understand what's happening with Adaline. Adaline is a fundamentally important algorithm because we are using Adaline for classifiers, regressors, whatever. For most machine learning algorithms, we use Adalines, and Adaline is a variant of, is a algorithm of the least mean. Well, you can use least mean squares to tune the parameters of an Adaline. Okay, please watch it. I will not go into the details of that talk. Okay, it is your business. All right. Welcome on board. And this artificial neural network centric discussion, we're going to make a historical perspective. We will discuss the neuron and its analytic model. We're going to see the inner product as a similarity measure, activation functions, differentiability, parameterization of, and the computational aspects. We will define the concept of learning, and then we will see the Hopfield neural network. Okay, we will see the Hopfield neural network. And in the second part, you will see the perceptron learning algorithms. That this is the perceptron learning algorithms is the case you will see in the previous two YouTube videos. Okay, that is a perceptron learning algorithm. Perceptron is an Adaline, a single neuron. Okay, perceptron learning algorithms, and those perceptron learning algorithms, I will show you several GIFs I produced this summer, and I suppose it will be funny. Okay. And the crux of this course is multi-layer perceptron and error backpropagation, as I have already introduced in the very first week of this, my webpage, which hasn't been updated yet. We will derive a learning algorithm. We will discuss the problems of the error backpropagation, memorization, overfitting, and generalization issues, which are important issues in any machine learning algorithm. We will consider the normalization of the things. And I will show you radial basis function neural networks, a kind of dynamic neural networks using some kind of second order filters in the synaptic part. We will consider second order training schemes, Levenberg-Marquardt algorithm and Gauss-Newton algorithm. We will consider, not go into the details of recurrent neural network structures, and I will try to show you several applications of neural networks like identification and control, for robotics, process control, whatever, noise elimination, noise cancellation, VLSI. I'm not a VLSI expert, so I will show you some pictures and very briefly, very shallow, briefly go into those topics, medical diagnosis, financial applications, and whatever. Then we will close the lecture with reinforcement learning and unsupervised learning. If there is no teacher, how can a system learn by using others' experiences and so on? This is an introductory course. As we have discussed the previous part, the LMS algorithm, this is an introductory course. In order to understand a paper fully, you have to consider that with your mathematical background in the deepest detail, let's say, okay? So if you are willing to work in deep learning or convolutional stuff, please go into YouTube and try to understand what a convolution is, what a signal is, what a one-dimensional, two-dimensional signal, what a Fourier transform is, which are totally beyond the content of this course, okay? Fourier transform, frequency, FFTs, please try to learn all those topics, which are really the fundamental topics in what in engineering. The story started in 1943 with McCullough and Pitts, a neural model, and then have published a book, The Organization of Behavior, in 1949. Okay, my father was 5 years old, okay, in 1949. That is the first mentioning of the synaptic modification. There are synapses in between the neurons, there are connections in between the neurons, and in between those connections, there is something, some electrochemical thing that is changing, and the result is the stupid human, okay? The result is the thinking biological machine, Utley in 1956, classification of simple sets using binary patterns. Rosenblatt in 1958 introduced perceptron. Widrow and Hopf, as I have shown you in the previous Word document in 1960, Widrow is the Bernard Widrow, introduced LMS algorithm for Adeline. Please go into YouTube and watch those two half an hour videos, okay? This is really very helpful. I mean, we are at a point there where the possibilities of the technology are ready for use, but 60 years ago, there were very clever people, and see the story of them, okay? Please try to understand the story of them. Minsky in 1961, credit assignment problem. Hopfield in 1982, when I was 10 years old, Hopfield networks, I mean, content addressable memories, Rumelhart, Hinton, and Williams in 1884, they introduced the error backpropagation algorithm. This was a turning point. Rumelhart, Hinton, and Williams. By the way, in 97, I was one of the listeners of the course offered by Geoffrey Hinton in Cambridge, London, okay? For 2 weeks, I took a course from Hinton. Hinton was he's a really clever person. Error backpropagation is the cracking point of these algorithms or these neural network algorithms. In Python, you import a scikit-learn package and you drop this course, okay? Because everything there is ready, you know, it works. Give the data, get the result, it works. Just, you know, it works. But you don't know how it works, okay? I offer this course every year to understand, to teach how the background processes work, okay? In one line, in MATLAB or Python or other languages, you can train your network, get your model, but the goal of this course is to convey you what is happening at the very fundamental level. Broomhead and Lowe in 88 introduced radial basis function neural networks. And after that, there are these three dots. I mean, millions of papers, millions of data, millions of, you know, data providing websites, whatever, Kaggles, data ports, UCI machine repositories, Pythons, packages, convolutional nets, deep nets, GPUs and whatever, okay? I will not go into those details, but I will show you the basics of this course. In the bottom left corner, you see the Mark I perceptron. This Mark I perceptron is implementing a perceptron structure that is shown on the top right corner. That is an inner product. The input is multiplied by a weight value. The input 2 is multiplied by another weight value. And each input is multiplied by a particular weight value. And you obtain a weighted output. And you add them up. you add a bias value that is, well, you can say a threshold, and pass the everything, pass the entire sum obtained here through a logistic function that is called the nonlinear activation function to obtain the output of a neuron. It is really very simple to draw, but when it comes to build a machine in 1960s, please watch those two videos. Well, you see Mark I perceptron looks like this, okay? That is a massive electrical circuit to implement a simple perceptron. Now it is, for today, is possible. It is really very simple to do all these things. There is a, you know, illustration of a neuron. There's an axon, nucleus, the processing element, but there are information coming from the other neurons. Okay, there are other. Well, I'm not a biologist, so these pictures looks nice, and basically the neuron has a number of branches to get information from other neurons and a center, a cell, to process the coming information. Okay, neuron is something like this. There's going to be a very fast, you know, summary. There are two classes. There are several classes that you can, you know, find a separator, as shown in here. There are infinitely many separators, but one of them is good, and you are looking for that separating class. So this is also a very simple problem for, you know, Python scikit or NumPys or whatever Python packages, but This is a fundamental problem. Now, identify friend and foe. In military, there are IFF structures. There are IFF modules to identify friend and foes. Okay, this is an important problem in engineering, especially for defense systems or production systems. I have 1 minute left here, and I will stop here. 10 minutes and then come back to discuss with you with the projects. Okay, if there are any questions that you were not able to ask during these 2 hours, I will come back to discuss. If you have no questions, you may go. If you have questions to ask me, you may come. Okay, 10 minutes break, and we are coming together again, right? Okay.